we treat after in this human life. Seriously, think about it for a moment. At this point in your life, what are you pursuing? Certainly, within such a diverse community as ours, with people of distinct ethnicities and races and genders and identities, with distinct ages and stages of life, what is a human quest? I'm sure it was ranged across the entire spectrum. But whatever it is that you're searching for, whatever it is that you are seeking, I wonder, have you considered the gravity, shall we say, the weightiness of what you are asking for? Have you considered the associated costs with that pursuit? Have you considered the ramifications attached to such a pursuit, the burden, the opposition, the stress, the hardship, the responsibility? Perhaps you have calculated the difficulties and still have made the decision to pursue it at all costs. Now, I'm not so sure that the disciples who approached Jesus with the day's wisdom made such calculations. They were chasing positions of honor, seats of recognition. However, Jesus checks their motives by saying, "You don't know what you are asking." Explanation. I wonder, do we truly understand what we are asking? Jesus follows up that comment with a question. He says, "Can you drink the cup I drink? Or receive the baptism I receive?" You see, the Eucharistic, the sacramental language is evident here. It's repeated in communion, in the Lord's Supper, in the sacrament of the altar, as Luther explained. It is said in the words of institution week after week after week. Those words are, "Again after supper, he took the cup, he thanked, and gave it for all to drink, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin.'" It is to say that the cup, the drink, the new covenant, is most visible in Jesus' blood poured out on the cross. I guess plainly said, the cup or the drink that Jesus is referring to is death itself. We call it self-denial. Jesus said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself." You've heard that before. "And take up their cross and follow me." But I'm not sure that we understand what self-denial means. Self-denial is the decision not to do or have something we want. Thus, self-denial is the decision to sacrifice yourself for others, to surrender yourself for the benefit of others or something else. And the kind of baptism that Jesus is referring to here is no water baptism, but a baptism that's drenched in suffering. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the German and Lutheran pastor, the theologian and martyr, he says how he speaks about suffering. He says it's not the religious act that makes the Christian, but the participation in the suffering of God in the life of the world. Suffering and self-denial are central themes, central motifs to Bonhoeffer's writings about the cross. He counted them, listen, as costs of discipleship. And they were central to human understanding. But do we understand our humanity and the reality of suffering and self-denial? Uso Gonzalez, the Cuban-American historian, theologian, and he's a prolific author, more than 100 with books, which, by the way, when I was in boxing, I got to spend several hours with Rousseau in his little Irish pub talking about theology, history, and the church. Such an amazing, unexpected experience, but all he did for like 3 hours was just pour into me and pour into me as I would ask question after question. This is how he writes about suffering. He says it in the following manner. It is as if, in a parade, some begin marching to a different tune. The rest, those who march to the common tune, will abuse them of upsetting the parade and will seek to suppress them or punish them. So let me pause here for a moment. So do not let the wisdom pass us by. So let the wisdom land ever so swiftly, ever so gently. So do not convince the Spirit's voice speaking to us this morning. I realize something. That we all come from very diverse theological backgrounds. That some of us have all kinds of embedded theologies, emotions, beliefs, doctrines, dogmas about suffering and self-denial. Some of us have been taught to suffer for Jesus. Have you heard that? To deny yourself from the things of this world, even so, to despise those who give themselves over to the worldly things, and that somehow our holiness, our proximity to God, is measured by our sacrificial living. By our self-denial to the things of this world. That the more we deny ourselves from this world, the closer we get to God. I remember when I was a teenager, my mom would say, "You can't listen to Snoop Dogg and Dr. Dre." But you can't go see that R-rated movie. Because the more I disassociated with the world, apparently the closer I would become to God. However, the more we focus on our personal pieties, on our personal righteousness, or our sentiment, shall we say, the more we become self-absorbed, the more we become judgmental. But I'm here to tell you that such thinking and such theologies are simply not helpful. The norm is that healing and liberation, they do not aid in the reconciling flow that is happening in our world. Instead, this is the only source, the image of self, the image of labor. The lineage of creation and the image of the divine. It's not only that the cup, the drink, the baptism that Jesus invites us into is so much more profound. The self-denial is not denying the earthly life. It is not denying the earthly things. Rather, it is the denial of anything that distorts God's love. Consider this, Jesus was willing, right, to drink the cup of self-denial. He was willing to be baptized in suffering. Now that is what we call true love. That kind of love is no ordinary kind of love. It is bold, it is intense, it is sheer, it is relentless, it is fearless. It is not intimidated by the threats of this world. It is not taken by the falsehoods of our society, nor is it deterred by the demonic ancient personalities of this world. This kind of love, this holy love, but this is the kind of love that I pray our community will have. That our community will experience. That our church, that our congregation will embody. A love that is embodied in the fullness of our life together. A love where saints and sinners can be authentic in themselves. A love that welcomes the radical hospitality of those who have been marginalized, those who have been banned from the church because of their identity and their sexuality. A love that offers dignity and respect to the weary traveler, because violence, war, hunger, climate shocks, and poverty are real global dynamics. dear to me. Giving itself over to racial unity, to racial reconciliation, where equity and justice rolls down like a river. This is precisely the question, right? Can you drink the cup I drink? Can you receive the baptism I receive? It is the denial of anything that distorts God's love enough in us. And if it gets in the way of loving one another, if it gets in the way of radical hospitality from the oppressed and the exploited, if it gets in the way of abiding in God's love, then yes, I will willingly drink the drink and be baptized in that baptism. I shall deny graces of because it distorts love for my neighbor of color. I shall deny homophobia and transphobia because it informs love for my queer and trans neighbor. I shall deny anti-immigrant, anti-brown, and anti-indigenous rhetoric that dehumanizes God's precious soul because it somehow disfigures love for my neighbor. And I shall deny sexism and misogyny because it somehow perverts God's love in me for my neighbor. You don't know what you're asking, Jesus said. To bear self-denial and suffering is to love the world like God loves the world. To love this world with the same fervor, with the same boldness as Jesus did, because the world is inherently good. It's very, very good, because this is what God's love does. It somehow breathes life into us. It somehow nourishes our souls. It awakens us. It moves us. It stirs us to be community with one another. Now we get whatever barriers arise, whether physical or social or economic or political or religious, that get in the way of loving the neighbor. Because how we live life has present-day impact. Now we're told not merely for the future, but hope for the present. I believe that the future that Jesus has prepared for us is liberating and healing and reconciling and is boundless with joy. But if you understand the world in such a way, to understand Jesus in such a way, it should impact the way I live in the present. For I know that God's love between us will send us into a world with joy and gladness, with the dancing and the sweetness, and the humming and the purring and the barking of the universal song that unites us with all creation. And that song will ring out in our urban centers and in our inner cities and in our suburban neighborhoods, summoning the grain of God into full completion on this earth, and our genuine love will ring out. And guess what? All human searching shall come to an end. All human pursuit shall be no more. No more pain, no more suffering, no more disease, no more death. Every peace and every tear shall be wiped away. And all things will be made new. So consider it. Enjoy the cost of discipleship. Self-denial and suffering, if it means that we get to love one another freely, if it means wholeness and total liberation for all creation, then I say yes. I do know what I am asking. I say yes, I will drink that cup and receive that baptism. Word of God and word of life, we all say together, thank you.